morning, everybody. It's great to be with you this morning. My name's Matthew, for those of you who don't know me. Phil started last week on a new series entitled True Discipleship. We're going to carry on that theme this week. And this week we're going to look at what it means to be a disciple, a true disciple, and what that means for us in terms of God's Word and the Bible. We're going to have a look at what it means to develop a discipline around studying the Bible and what impact that has on us trying to live Christian life. Discipline is not a particularly fashionable word these days, and that's fair to say. Maybe it conjures up images to some people in this room of maybe an overbearing father, or maybe people overstepping their authority at work even, and that discipline can be seen in quite a negative way. And actually, if you look at the history of the word discipline, you can see a few hundred years ago when people were using Middle English in England, the term actually did have that religious connotation as well, mortification by scourging oneself. I'm sure there are a few people in here who have scourged themselves, maybe not literally, but have scourged themselves in regard to the Bible, and at least some guilt and some shame around whether you read the Bible, whether you read it enough, whether you understand it, whether you enjoy it. I'm sure there is some guilt and shame around that thing. But actually, if we look at the sort of history, the roots of the word, what we can see, first of all, is that the word disciple and the word discipline share a common root. And if we go back to that Latin common root, disciple, we actually see that there's a much more positive story behind that word, discipline. Disciple means to be a student, a learner, or a follower. And so to develop a discipline is to study, is to learn, and is to follow something. So what does it mean then to study, to learn from, and to follow God's word for us living here today? I want to look this morning at a character from the Bible, not one maybe we always look at very regularly, so it might not be one that we know that much about. But I want to look at the Old Testament prophet Ezekiel's life, which is recorded in the book of Ezekiel in the Old Testament. Ezekiel lived about 500 to 600 years before Christ. He lived at a time in Israel's history when Israel had been led by kings, and you can read about that in 1 Kings and 2 Kings, who got involved in some quite dark things. We're not just talking like bad people. They got involved in some ritual and worship of the people who lived around them that led them to do some really quite horrific things. And you can read all about that. And God had to say, enough is enough. This can't continue. And the people of Israel ended up going into exile because they were taken capture by the Babylonian Empire. Israel became part of that empire, and a lot of people were taken from Israel and were taken to Israel, to Babylon, sorry. And Ezekiel, who was a priest in the temple at the time, was chosen by God to be a prophet, somebody who would be sent to the people of Israel to call them back to him, to go to their context where they were, having done this wrong, having been removed from the promised land ultimately, to call them back, not just to call them back so that they could go back to the land, but to call them back to him. What can Ezekiel then tell us about the word of God and creating that discipline for us today, all these thousands of years later, developing that discipline around reading the Bible and reading God's word? Well, what we're going to find out when we have a little look at the early accounts of his life is that Ezekiel, despite being a priest, despite them being chosen as the prophet, call them back, he was somebody who could only fulfill his calling when he was given the word of God. He was someone who could only fulfill his calling once he received God's word. We go to the next slide. In chapter 1, we see Ezekiel receiving a vision from God. It's quite a famous vision, but it's also quite a complicated vision. A lot of sort of imagery and symbolism that I'm not going to go into this morning. All sorts of animals and wheels turning. Lots of what we're saying in worth maybe a lot of moving parts going on in that vision. But what's important, what I think is important for us this morning about that vision, is that Ezekiel sees in that vision the glory of God. In verse 28 it says, "This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of God. When I saw it, I fell face down and I heard the voice of the one speaking." Not many people have seen the glory of God. Not many people have had that privilege, not many people have had that honor, particularly maybe on that side of the cross. But Ezekiel saw it. Ezekiel saw the glory of God. Not many people have lived after seeing the glory of God. But Ezekiel managed to write it down in quite vivid words for us in his book, or somebody did on his behalf at least. And yet, Ezekiel, we'll find out, was somebody who still needed the word of God to go alongside that experience. See, in the second chapter of Ezekiel, he's sent out to be a prophet on behalf of God. In verse 3 it says, "Son of man, I'm sending you to the Israelites, to a rebellious nation that has rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have been in revolt against me to this very day." There would have been loads of priests in the temple. Loads would have probably gone, probably being educated people would have probably been sent to Babylon as well, because they would have been seen as useful. And yet he's the one who's chosen to be the prophet. He's the one who's selected to call the nation of Israel back. And yet, we'll see in chapter 3, if we go to the next slide, that Ezekiel couldn't do that, couldn't fulfill what he'd been called to do until he'd been given the word of God. It says in verse 8, "But you, son of man, God speaking to Ezekiel, listen to what I say to you. Do not rebel like that rebellious people. Open your mouth and eat what I give you." Then I looked and I saw a hand stretched out to me. In it was a scroll which he unrolled before me. On both sides of it were written words of lament and mourning and woe. And he said to me, "Son of man, eat what is before you. Eat this scroll, then go and speak to the people of Israel." So I opened my mouth, and he gave me the scroll to eat. Then he said to me, "Son of man, eat this scroll I am giving you, and fill your stomach with it." So I ate, and it tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth. Ezekiel, given a vision, he's sent out. He knows what he needs to do. Before he can do that, God has to prepare him with his word. God has to give him his word so that he can fulfill what he needs to do. At Einan, we've been given a vision. Phil, in the series before Easter, went through that vision with us really clearly. He went through week by week what that vision was, what this church has been called to. He went through the prophecies that this church has been given and showed us what it is that we need to do. Einan has, in response to a vision, had this building renovated so that this community of believers can go out and reach the community around us. We've had the vision, we've been sent. And like Ezekiel, we need the word of God in our lives, both as a church and as individuals, if we are ultimately going to reach and meet and fulfill the vision and the sending out that we've received from God. We have to have the word of God central to everything we do. We have to have the word of God at the heart of our lives. And we have to take the word of God seriously. We're going to see what God has for us fulfilled. So what does it mean to fulfill, what does it mean to take seriously, the word of God? What does that actually mean in our lives? How does that actually look for us today? We go to the next slide. We'll see that there's a few key ideas, I think, in that third chapter that really show us, I think, what it is that we need to be doing and what it is that we can do daily in our lives, routinely, to take seriously the word of God. The says in verse 3, chapter 3, eat what is before you. That's what God says to Ezekiel. He says, eat what is before you. We are to approach the word of God as we approach food. We are to approach the word of God in a way like we would our meals. We're to do so regularly. We're to do so routinely. We're definitely to do so daily, maybe more than once a day. I know if you add in the snacks, for me, I've got a lot of Bible reading to do. Jeremiah, a prophet who crossed over with Ezekiel's life, said that he devoured the word of God. He also uses that imagery of coming to eat it, coming to sort of partake in something like you would partake in a meal. But to come to it regularly, routinely, daily. Richard Foster, who wrote a book that many of you will know, A Celebration of Discipline, it's really worth reading. It's quite old now, but it's really well worth reading if you haven't. Says, remember, the mind will always take on an order conforming to the order on which it concentrates. Quite a bit of a mouthful there. But what Richard Foster is saying is, we will conform to that which we concentrate on, ultimately. We'll become what we focus on. We'll become what we prioritize. And as Christians, there are many things in this world that we can focus on, that we can concentrate on. And so we've got to choose to come to it like we do to food. Can't go without food. Can't miss it easily for very long. How does that look then? Well, I'll be the first to admit that I'm not somebody who's had an excellent routine or rhythm of reading the Bible my entire life. But during the lockdown, when things got a bit less busy, when there was a bit, for some of us, I'll add for myself, and there was a bit more time to sort of stop, I started to read the Bible just one chapter a day. I've tried to do sort of Bible in a year a number of times. I've never finished it. I don't get that thing of moving about the Bible every day. I'm somebody who likes routines, so I like to do the next chapter and just go like that. But I found that a chapter a day is what works for me. It'll take me 5 years to get through the Bible, but that's okay, isn't it? Hopefully I've got 5 years left. But that's just what works for me. That's just a routine. It's just about starting somewhere. Just about finding what that routine is for you and not being scared of it. Not thinking it's something that's really difficult. That's just my experience. But the Israelites, when they're in the desert, are given manna by God to sustain them. And they're given their portion every day. And I think there's something in what Ezekiel is saying here. Eat what is before you every day. You don't have to do some big, impressive study of the Bible every day. But if you just read that next chapter, if you just read whatever is next, read the next thing. Have your portion. Take your manna, like the Israelites went out and got it every morning. We're told in Deuteronomy 8, in reference to the manna, that man cannot live by bread alone. And it's true. Come to it like we would to food. But it needs to be almost alongside that food to sustain us in the way that food sustains our physical bodies. In verse 3 it says, fill your stomach with it. Don't just taste it. We're told to fill our stomachs with it. Archbishop Thomas Cranmer, when he wrote the Common Book of Prayer in the 16th century, he wrote in the collect for the second Sunday in Advent these words. Blessed Lord, who has caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us that we may, in such wisdom, hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest. It's that last bit, inwardly digest, that I'm pretty sure probably Thomas Cranmer got from this passage in Ezekiel when he was writing the Common Book of Prayer. So not just about tasting it, it's about filling ourselves with it. It's about digesting it and understanding what it means. And I think this is us now moving from studying the Bible to meditating on the Bible. How does that look for me? That looks, if I'm reading one chapter a day, one verse stands out to me, I meditate on that. I meditate, and again, don't always get that far, but when I do, meditate on that verse that just jumps out to you. How does that look? Meditating doesn't require you to levitate or wear saffron robes. It's just closing your eyes, thinking about the verse, ruminating on the verse. In the same way as your body digests food so that the good stuff stays in your body, it's about it ruminating, thinking over on that one verse so that you get the good stuff, the stuff that God's speaking to you, the stuff that God is saying to you. That's what digesting, inwardly digesting God's word looks like. And finally, Peter also says in verse 3, when he ate it, digested it, it tasted sweet as honey. The word of God is sweet. It says so as well in Psalm 119. The author of Proverbs says so in Proverbs 16:2. It's sweet because it speaks directly to our situation. Something that was written thousands of years ago, when we read it in the morning or in the evening or whenever, it speaks to the thing that you're worrying about the next morning. It comforts you for that thing that's been going on for ages and is causing you a real problem. It challenges you to do what's right. It changes your mind about what you should be doing. And there's something beautiful about that. There's something beautiful about this book genuinely being alive. As alive as we are. It's speaking to every day in the same way as we live every day. It's sweet. But I wonder as well, when Ezekiel refers to the word of God being as sweet as honey, whether for him as well he may have been thinking about something else as well. Thinking if you lived in the ancient world, like Ezekiel did, the sensation of sweetness wouldn't have been necessarily something that you would experience that often. Today, you know, there's probably chocolate in this room. There's probably chocolate in your house that you've forgotten about. Chocolate, sweet stuff is everywhere. Sweet sensations are just the norm for us. Probably we can agree that we have them too often, don't we? In the ancient world, sweetness was not really a part of the diet or the experience in the same way. Honey and fruit would probably have been the main experiences of that sensation. And honey would have probably been something wild rather than something that you would have a hive for. So probably wouldn't have been something that Ezekiel may have experienced that often. And so I wonder here as well whether Ezekiel is referring to the word of God being sweet as honey. He's also referring it to how it can overwhelm you, to its power. The way in which when you taste honey even now, gosh, it's sweet, isn't it? Even to our taste buds, it's sweet. Can you imagine, though, what maybe that would have been like for somebody who'd never tried sugar, who didn't have that as a part of their regular diet? It would have been overwhelming, I think. And it would have been really quite powerful, a really powerful sensation. And the Word of God is powerful, isn't it? The Word of God is powerful when we read it every day. It speaks to us. And like I was saying, it can change your mind. It can challenge you in such a way that you get up from reading it and do things differently. That you can see the world completely differently from reading a passage of the Bible. Now that's power, isn't it? In a world where all sorts of influences are constantly trying to influence us, there's a power in this book, there's a power in the Word of God that is just different to other things. It reminds me of the story of Robert Germain Thomas. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Robert Germain Thomas, but he lived in a Presbyterian minister who lived in Hanover in Monmouthshire, so not very far away from here. And he, at the age of, very young age, so 22, 24, decided to go and be a missionary in China. When he got to China, he was a missionary, but he felt a very strong burden for the people of the Korean Peninsula. And the Korean Peninsula at the time was closed to the outside world. It didn't want outside influence, particularly from the West. It's not something it wanted. And so it said, you know, do not come here. We do not want to be influenced. We will not trade with you. And somehow Robert Jermaine Thomas manages to persuade an American vessel that I think is going elsewhere to go to Pyongyang, which is now, of course, the capital of North Korea. And as that ship, as that vessel is going up towards Pyongyang, up the peninsula, it's close to the shoreline at times, and he throws Bibles onto the shoreline. Ultimately, the vessel runs aground, and due to some of the hostilities, I suppose, around outside forces and the local people, Robert Jermaine Thomas and others end up being killed. But the story goes that some of those Bibles that landed on the beach or landed on the shoreline were picked up, and someone decided that the pages of those Bibles would be useful to wallpaper their house. And it is said that from the wallpaper on that person's house, the people read it, became Christians, and that a church was founded on the Korean peninsula. I know some of you may know that the church in South Korea is an extremely strong church today, and unbelievably too, the church in North Korea, despite experiencing some of the most unbelievable persecution the world's ever seen, is also pretty strong, considering. Korea is now a place where there's a church. Korea is now a place where there's a witness, Jesus Christ. And it's not because what Robert Jermaine Thomas said, not because of the activities and the logistical skills he had as a missionary when he got there. It's simply because he put the Word of God at the center of his mission, at the center of his vision, at the center of what he was sent to do. And the Word of God had its own power that didn't really require him to do anything more than what he did. Because the Word of God is powerful, and it will overwhelm forces that are trying to stop it. It will overwhelm people who are trying to stop it. Einan has a vision. Einan has been sent. We need to put the Word of God at the center of that vision, if we are to see it, that vision, that thing we've been sent to, fulfilled. Power in the Word of God. We must eat it. We must digest it. And it's as sweet as honey. We must let it overwhelm us so it can overwhelm the people that we're going to reach. I'm going to pray. Dear Lord, thank you for being with us this morning. Thank you for the gift of your Word. Thank you for the way you speak to us through it. Thank you that we can come into it afresh, morning by morning. And it doesn't matter what happened yesterday, it doesn't matter what's happening tomorrow, that you speak, Lord. That you would help us to have a discipline, to see a discipline as a good thing, to enjoy your Word, to devour your Word, Lord Jesus. I pray as we go out of here this week, we would see the Bible, see your Word in a new light, and that we would develop that routine and rhythm, maybe like we never have before. In your name.